Good morning, and welcome to Conversations in Christ. We invite you to sit back, open your Bible, and engage in a dialogue as we learn together more about the incredible gift of grace that God has given all of us. Now, let's reason together in love.
Okay, well, I want to say good morning to all our viewers out there on podcasts and our listeners on KNCO radio. We don't know how many there are, but maybe that's better that we don't know, but welcome. And we're also on Channel 11 local cable TV, and that's Nevada County Media. And welcome to all them, and welcome Donna this morning. And welcome to our returning guest, Ken Page. He's the owner of Frier Tuck in Nevada City, and Bill's out today. He's busy doing stuff, so it's just the three of us, and this should be a delightful time. Let me just say a little something about Ken. Ken was on, he was a guest a year ago, and Donna, it was when Mike passed away, mm-hmm. and you couldn't make it to the shows, and we called Ken, and he came in, and we had three great shows. In fact, I've even made a separate playlist on the website with the Ken Page shows. And we're going to add these to that. You get your own playlist, buddy. So you're a true guest. And anyway, he owns Frier Tuck in Nevada City, a great hangout. It's very delightful. The atmosphere is good, not just the food and the beauty of the restaurant, but there's just the folks that come and the way Ken runs it, and he gets around, says hi to people, and he even lets me play music there occasionally. So, you know, in the bar, he keeps me in the bar. And, but anyway, it's a great little establishment. And there's even a kind of a ministry to people aspect of it that he does, just very people oriented. And then I've gotten to know Ken on his, he has a study with some folks, and just the stuff he shares I've just found to be delightful. So I know this is going to be a really good set of shows. So welcome, Ken.
Oh, glad to be here.
Good morning, Ken.
So as we usually do, usually I say, hey, Bill, where are we heading today? And we don't have Bill. So what we do with guests is we usually just let them share what's on their heart, and then we tag along with questions and comments and see where it goes. So
yeah.
Ken, welcome, and what's on your heart today? What kind of a conversation in Christ can we have with you this morning?
It's easy to begin talking about it because, you know, it sounds weird, but I was reading Job, and Job starts out, and, you know, I'm always trying to identify my life with those that, you know, walk before us and how they live their lives, and I'm thinking of a guy that had, you know, 10 kids, you know, he had three daughters, three daughters, seven sons. And God said about him, he's my man. He's very successful. He takes care of his kids. He's blessed them. He's a very wealthy kind of guy. And I grew up in Silicon Valley. I mean, not grew up, but I lived there for so long. I associated with a lot of people that, you know, had a lot of stuff. So it's normal for me to just kind of think of this cool guy, you know, that's walking around. And then what really got to me, and I think this is a cool thing to contemplate, is that we're blessed by God. He, you know, we live in with God, and he's around us. But then the angels came to God one day, and Satan was with them. And God brought up, what about my guy? What about Job? And he brought it up, and he said, what about him? And here's what got to me, and it's something we could talk about. Satan says to him, the only reason he really loves you and he likes you is you've blessed him so much. You've given him all this good stuff. But if you take it away, he's not going to like you. So it hit my heart because so much of life is, I mean, yeah, you want to be happy, you want to enjoy life and all that, but I was really getting to the heart of my relationship with him, and I'm saying, you know, conversation, you know, with him, and I'm saying, you know, I kind of thought that too. Like, if you take this away, am I really gonna like you? You know, are we still gonna have a relationship? And I think it's a good heart question not with condemnation or guilt, but it's just that, you know, he wants to know that we love him just for who he is and not for all that he gives us. So the conversation that really struck me is Satan's words are the ones that came alive to me, like, hey, if you take this away, he's not going to like you. And I'm going, whoa, you know, that kind of, you know, it kind of pierces your heart, you know, it gives you something to talk about that it's kind of hard to talk about, but it's true.
Absolutely. And you probably, you know, I would imagine sometimes that you meet people and they're going through tough times too.
Mm-hmm.
And you probably encourage them.
Yeah.
And it's not to say that Job didn't struggle, because he did. That wasn't the issue. Right. But he never denied God. He never said, I'm out of here, like his wife did. Not that always it's the wife. Sometimes it's the husband that bails. But he did struggle. And that's what the book's all about. That's why I think it's a key book, because it's not that he just sprang back and he was the super believer. He says, I cursed the way I was born. He cursed just about everything except God.
Mm-hmm.
He says, I still trust you. Though you slay me, I will trust you. Wow. You know?
Yeah. So, what I think about is there's a lot to it, but what I came to was at the very end, he got what he really wanted. He, in the end, it said, I knew about you. But then he said, now I know you. And it was through that. I mean, for those of us that hunger, you know, and long, and you want a deep relationship, a loving relationship with the Father, he'll take you through that so you can get what you really want. You know, he's a good Father, and he'll take you through all of that, and he won't leave you hanging. I mean, it's up to him to do what he wants, but he knows my heart. You know, I get fire talks, I come to Bada City, I'm doing what I'm doing. But he knows my heart is, I like all of this stuff. I want to know him. You know, I want to know him, and I want to know the people. I want it all. And he knows how to get me there. That's the good part. You know, he'll get me to where I can really be satisfied, you know, in my life, and whether it's struggle or not. Yeah.
And so in Job's dark times, God was with him through it all, right?
Mm-hmm.
That was the whole point. And that's when you know you can really trust your Father.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, I like that. He took him from knowing about God to knowing God.
Yeah.
And once he took him there, then he could give him good things, and those good things wouldn't get in between him and God. They would just be blessings. And it had to be done in that order. It's not like he said, okay, Job, I'm going to test you, and if you pass the test, I got all kinds of goodies for you. Job didn't know where this was headed.
No.
And it's better that he didn't know, because it was the journey and making that transition from knowing about God to knowing him and knowing his heart and character and that he could trust him, that Job became stronger and more prepared to live even a more abundant life than he did before.
Mm-hmm. And you know, there's another aspect of that really blessed me is his buddies, three of the buddies, you know, that were coming alongside talking to him. In the end, God said that they didn't represent him, that they were trying. I think this is a good thing to talk about. You want to come and you want people to comfort you, you know, when you're in it. And God brought up throughout the story, you were trying to accuse him. You know, you're saying, oh, he's sick. Therefore, you have sin in your life. You know, you're suffering because God is mad at you. And all of those were just condemnation and guilt. And all he wanted was comfort.
Right.
And so here's a man that's receiving, and I'll say it personally, that for me, it's kind of like my head voices, you know, the religious voices in my head that would say, oh, you're not, oh, you have secret sin. You have, no, God says, no, you got it wrong. This man loves me. Stop telling him what he has to do to get better. Just comfort him.
Yeah.
You know? And it meant a lot to me, because like you said, Donna, the people go through a lot of stuff and you want to come alongside. You don't want to give them a script, you know, like, oh, do this. Or what do you have going on? Or, you know, God's after you. You know, I mean, come on.
Absolutely. I was hearing a message, I think it was by Malcolm Smith, and it was on the Pearl of Great Price, and he was talking about God going, you know, as in the clamshell, that God going into that darkness and into that shell, that oyster shell. And over time, it's very, you know, it's very difficult what goes on in there. But what comes out is that,
yeah.
Pearl, and we are that pearl.
Yeah, yeah.
And he said that's the only gem. That's the gem of all gems in the Bible, because it comes out perfect. It doesn't have to be cut and polished and all of that.
Right, right.
And so I kind of think about that when I think about the struggles. Is God right there? Just, and it's such an intimate relationship.
Yeah, exactly.
You wouldn't have that had you not, if we didn't go through those struggles, we wouldn't have that intimacy.
He really wants to make us happy.
Absolutely.
No matter what.
We just don't know what it's going to look like.
You know, I don't want to. I don't want to do this to get there.
By the way, the pearl is the result of an irritation inside the bean, and it churns and it works it, and what comes out of it is a pearl that started out as an irritation and a
gritty
bit of suffering,
a gritty mess, right?
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah. Well, you know, he says in another place. He said, "I penned up all men to disobedience, so I can show my mercy." And I go, wow, you mean that you planned all this agitation so we can feel your mercy and get to know you? It's kind of a flip view of it's worth it. You know what I mean? It's worth, I mean, he wants us so badly that we're able to endure so we can get to really be happy, you know? So we have to learn to just let him do what he does and enjoy it and go through it. So we can be happy.
Yeah, that passage is in the end of Romans chapter 11. It's really at the end of that big first 11 chapters where he tells about salvation and everything before he launches into 12, where he says, let love be without hypocrisy, and gives you all these practical things. His grand conclusion for the first 11 chapters is God has put everybody in a situation where they're going to be tested, and for the purpose of the better purpose, for the good purpose that he's going to bring. Because that's the business he's in. He's in the business of saving, restoring, correcting. He's not a destroyer. He's not looking for who he can do in. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just the whole character of God is good and nothing but good. But there are difficulties in the process.
Yep.
That he has apparently designed and built into life, not to be cruel, but to bring us to something better. Yeah. And I think better than we would have been if we had just made innocent little children in a garden and pats us on the head and says, oh, I love you. And we go, thank you, Daddy. I'm not sure what love means, but I love you too. When we love God after we go through all we go through, the love is very genuine. And it's not only does he enjoy it, but it's a better love for us to experience with him and with others.
Exactly. You know, one of the things that helped couch the entire situation is, you know, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he's going to be with me. I got a whole new revelation of this recently that, take it back. What if the day the curse came and the sin came into the world, he goes, and you're born, though you're born into the valley of the shadow of death, I'm going to be with you. Mm-hmm. So it creates the picture of what we're born into, where so much of my life was, I'm creating my life. And he goes, no, you're born into this. And you don't even understand what you're born into. You know, you're born into a death, which is affliction and sickness and pain. And yeah, that's the natural. So the reason you say, he saves you not from that, but he gives you faith. You can endure it. You can endure the adversity. But we live in such a, I mean, I have, and many of us in America have lived under the protection, you know, of what he created here in America. so that we don't experience what many of the people in the world with suffering and all of that. So we're somewhat in a bubble, and we don't really get, though I was born into the valley of the shadow of death, I don't have to fear. He'll always be with me.
Right. So
every struggle I have is go, yeah, you were born into this. It's not new. It's not coming upon you like you're a bad person. We just happen to be around a lot of nice people we like. I'm with you guys, you know, we hang out, we get along. But for many, it's not that way. You know, you're born in adversity. So the blessing that you don't experience it 24 hours a day is a blessing.
Well, we're pearls in the making.
Yeah, we are.
We are, but I don't like the process.
Oh, no, who does?
But I always look back and I go, I hate that process. I would never sign up for it. I would just soon have avoided it. But I look back and I go, I am so thankful for what came out of it. And a lot of that took most of my 73 years to come to that rich conclusion. When I was younger, I'm just trying to endure to get through it, you know, and hope for a better day. And now I look back and go, even though I didn't appreciate it and I didn't understand what was going on, I still gained from it greatly, more than I realized at the time. And that just makes me so thankful today as an old guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Is there a way, you know, when you've been walking this grace walk for such a long time, that you, even though you know you're in this struggle, that you can appreciate it while you're in it? You know, it's almost like a mixed feeling of, you know, God's got something in there for it. You know what you're going through is going to be for your good, but it's terrible, you know, at times.
You know what I found, you know, I have a restaurant, so I get to walk around and talk to people all the time. And it's so refreshing to me, Donna, what you're saying, that I give them what I have, which is what I'm going through. It's not what I've gotten over, you know, like Carl, what you were just saying.
Mm-hmm.
To me, you know, I see somebody and they go through it, and really what they want to know is, how are you dealing with struggle?
Yeah.
You know, that's really all they want to know. I mean, as far as comfort, all I want to know when I have my stuff, you know, we all have it. I just want to know, I talk to you, Carl, I talk to you, Donna, and you go, this is what I'm doing. I mean, I'm struggling with you.
Yeah, we can comfort each other in the struggle.
In it.
And a lot of people are struggling in particular right now.
Yeah.
And they just want to know that, you know, it's almost like people hold deep secrets because maybe they want to save face or whatever. Just being able to share that struggle.
Yeah.
Part of our humanity, that God has given us that love to share.
Yeah, and I think that, I think the greatest love I share is my weakness, that I'm going through it too.
That's right.
I got a guy here in the kitchen. He's going through all kinds, you know, a guy we hire, he's going through all kinds of stuff. And he's not here for me to give him a bunch of Bible verses or tell him to live life. What he wants to know is me too. They don't see, you know, I'm a business owner. So, he's got his life together. But I can always find something in me that says, you know what, I struggle with that too. I mean, it might be a different, you know what I'm saying, it might be different, but I struggle. You say, you know, this is what I do. You know, I remember sitting with a guy and he's telling me all his problems. Those problems are off the chart, like something I've never experienced. And I said, you know, I've never experienced those, but this is what I do. You know, I say, God allows us to say our heart, just let it out, talk, and he'll meet you in it. You know, he'll meet me, and sometimes he does it the way I like it, and sometimes he doesn't, but guess what? He'll be there. He's there for you. So it's not, I'm not trying to get him through it. I'm just trying to be with him in it. Like, I'm in it, you're in it. Carl's in it. Donna, you're in it.
There you go. That means more. They don't need more religion from us. What they need is relationship from us.
Yeah,
with us.
Exactly.
So it helps to tell them, okay, I was there once and I got through it, and they go, well, good for you.
Right.
What brings greater comfort, and that's part of it, that's good to know, but is, hey, here's what I'm going through right now, and here's how I'm dealing with it, and they go, wow, I can relate to that. Mm-hmm. So you had Job's friends, interestingly, they sat down with him for 7 days and seven nights in silence and comforted him, and they started out relationship. feeling for you, but then guess what reared its ugly head was religion.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, hey, I'm going to fix you. I'm irritated that you must have done something wrong here and all that religious nonsense.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and they need to stay in the relationship.
You're right. And I think the compassion comes, to me, it's more, I have the compassion for the struggle. Yeah. Like, oh, I have it too. We can relate on the same thing that we struggle. And in the world, there's going to be struggle. But I have a place. I always say to people, I struggle like you, but at least I have a place to go. I have somebody to talk to about this, you know. Yeah. Then he fixes it or works on it or whatever.
Yeah. And sometimes it's less words. It's just being with them, not without them knowing anything about you, but knowing who you are and what you're going through. And you're not trying to give them Bible verses and fix them and correct them and get them through it, but going through it with them and saying, hey, I'm here for you. I'm here for you. I feel it. I'm so sorry. How can I be with you? How can I be present with you? How can I help you? I'll be in the back office. You're in the kitchen. Let me know if you need anything. So without even saying those words, that guy knows if he needs anything, he can come to you, you know?
And I think, you know, and what I'm really realized, I was in Silicon Valley and you're somewhat insulated, protected from the rest of the world. But when I got to the nitty gritty blue collar, you know, business restaurant world, you begin to say, what can you share with people? And the thing you can share is you really don't have all the answers. You don't know what's going on. And we talk about appointments. I think the appointments are in our suffering. And what I mean by that is, I know the struggles I have in my heart, and God will bring you people that are struggling with similar things. So you can relate in the struggles, you know, more than, trying to tell them what to do. So to me, I have found so much more fellowship in the midst of that than trying to get them to say, well, pray for more money or pray for a bigger house or, you know what I'm saying? I've done all of that. I mean, we all do that, but yeah, you want the blessing, but I'm just saying that the relationships I'm finding deeper are, I mean, all the struggles we've been through in the last few years with COVID and the breakup of people. And, you know, you can really relate to that, you know, the deep struggle of family breakdown, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
You know, being I was raised in religion, and, you know, it was always about trying to invite people to church or giving them some kind of a testimony, or this is how you, you know, gain salvation and all. But what you're doing, I mean, what we're talking about right now,
what
you're able to do is really living that Christ life.
Yeah, it is.
And that's all we have to do is just walk there and let our light shine as much as we can, and in the struggle, and share that. Exactly. It's our humanity, and we're all in it together.
It's so real, because like you were saying, Don, a lot of people try to, they feel like they have to hold it in.
Yeah.
I can say, yeah, I hold it in to a point, but when I get alone and I open the word, you know, I just let it out. I can tell them everything I want to tell them, and then talk to you guys too and say, how are you doing with it? You know, you have the same stuff going on as I do. Let's talk about it, you know, and I'm not wanting to get into the bad, you know, I don't want a total negative conversation. I want, how are you getting out of this? How are you working through this? How do you live day by day, you know, with?
And you're not alone.
And you're not alone. There you go.
We're not alone. He's with us 24/7, or the Spirit, I mean, is with the Holy Spirit's in us all the time. When you wake up in the middle of the night in fear or whatever, because oftentimes that's, as a therapist, I hear from people, they either go to bed worrying or they wake up in the night and can't go back to sleep and then
start,
you know, ruminating. And then, but it's amazing. You get up and you start, and the beauty of it is when you do see people, as you do and as I do, it all kind of dissipates, because you realize that we all possess this love.
Yeah. 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 And it's so cool. It's a freedom. I think the freedom of the soul is comes first, and the freedom outside, you know what I'm saying? And we need that. I mean, that's the love we can share, is that, you know, there's no greater love that I have than I can share my heart with him, you know, let him work on me. So when I walk around outside, I got a little bit more to share.
Yeah.
It comes from inside out. And if I think I'm going to fix somebody else and I'm not fixed, or you know what I'm saying? You know, nobody fixes each other, but God does fixing. He does. Yeah. He actually does.
Okay. Well, listen, we're about out of time, believe it or not.
That's too much fun.
It's too much fun. So, Ken, I hope you'll come back next week.
I'll be planning on it.
Okay, this is going to be good. We'll continue where we left off, and we'll do another show.
Yeah,
and I just want to let everybody know we've got a website at conversationsinchrist.net, and on there we've got all our shows, past, present, and even future. Like these shows will be up there before they go out over the air because they're in podcasts. So, and we have great resources. We have a book list. You can give us feedback. We'd love to hear from you. Good, bad, indifferent, whatever. Love to hear from you. So thanks for tuning in, folks. We'll see you next week. God bless you. And we love
you. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to Conversations in Christ. Our prayer is that today's program has opened your heart and mind to a greater understanding and curiosity about the gift of grace that God has given to each of us in and through His Son, Jesus Christ. Remember, you have been blessed with every spiritual blessing by God, so that you may believe and begin to experience the very life of God in you. Tune in again next week for Conversations in Christ.
If you have a comment or a question, we would love to hear from you. You can contact us at conversationsinchrist.net. That's conversationsinchrist.net.